Good to see you. I'm glad you came out today for church, and I trust that God's going to bless you because of it. I know it's a little bit treacherous maybe in some places, but we're grateful that you came and just like to welcome you, especially if you're a guest today. We'd love to say welcome to you and ask you if you would to do us a favor and take the communication card in front of you there in the pew and fill that out and drop that in the offering box later on. They're scattered throughout. And of course, online, you can do the same thing with the Connect card. They give us a record of your attendance and give us an opportunity to just share some things with you. And just a reminder also, if you did come prepared to give today, there are offering boxes all over the place that you can use. And we'll just thank you for that. I'm probably going to mention this next week because there's not as many of us here today. But you know, our Lottie Moon Christmas offering was $43,000. I'm very excited to tell you today, the last count I heard was over $76,000. And I'm sure that's probably got to be a record for our church, but thank the Lord. Of course, every penny of that's going to go to international missions, so we're grateful for that. Let me remind you that next Sunday that we will be having a baptism, I believe, in this service, and some of you may be thinking about baptism, maybe some other things. After the service this morning, myself, Billy, Terry, we'll be around down front if you'd like to discuss baptism or anything else, or you just like somebody to pray with you, we'll be here with you for that. And speaking of prayer, why don't we just pause right now and bow our heads and ask God's blessing on this time, okay? So join me in prayer. Father, we are reminded that we need your blessing. And Lord, we thank you that it's not because of us, but it's in spite of us, Lord, that you would bless us anyway. Lord, we are so aware, Lord, of how short we fall of your perfection. But Lord, we thank you for what Martin Luther called an alien righteousness, a righteousness outside of ourselves that was imputed to us. And because of that, we can be forgiven. We can be a part of the family of God. And we're grateful, Lord, that we could come as a family this morning and worship you in spirit and in truth. And Lord, I pray that as we sing, we would sing from the heart. I pray that that you would give Pastor Roland a freedom as he preaches. And Lord, help us to be receptive to whatever it is you would speak to us about today. So we want to commit this time to you now. In Jesus' name, amen.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Amen? Amen. And the battle belongs to the Lord. Will you stand if you're able and join with us singing Battle Belongs?
When all I see is a mountain.
belongs to our God. Let's sing now. Agnus Dei means Lamb of God. Sing our praise to our Lord. Ladies, let's begin.
Hallelujah.
Eleison. Lord, have mercy. Sing this with us. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for allowing us to call you Lord. Dear my Father, be with Roland now as he brings the message. Lead us and guide us. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Hey, good morning. I want to welcome you this morning as well as Scott. And one thing I know about you, you're here because you want to be here. You had every excuse in the world not to be here, and you chose to be here. So I trust that God's going to give us a good time together as we look into his word. And let me kind of give you my perspective on that. Having been from the country, I relate to country stories, and I heard the story that took place down in the Squatchy Valley of a little country church, very tiny group of people. And one snowy January morning, the brand new pastor showed up, but only one member, one farmer came to church that day. Well, the pastor just went ahead and preached the message that God had given him. And when it was over, the man came up to him and said, you know, I thought since it was just me here that you might just have like a 10-minute devotional. He said, well, no. He said, He said, why would you think that? He said, you know, I had a message and I wanted you to hear it. He said, well, preacher, he said, when I'm a farmer, whenever I go to feed the cows, he said, I'll have a wagon load of hay. And he said, if all the cows show up, I feed them. But he said, if only one cow shows up, I don't put out the whole wagon load. I just throw out one bale. Well, we're going to give you the whole wagon load. And that's just the way I'm going to approach it. And I trust that you'll be okay with that. I want you, if you would, to take your Bible and turn to 1 Peter chapter 4. We are inchworming our way through the book of 1 Peter. And this morning we've come to an interesting passage. Let's begin in verse 7, if we may, and read through verse 11. The end of all things is near. Therefore, be of sound judgment and sober spirit for the purpose of prayer. Now, let me just pause right there and tell you how I came up with the title. One of the things I do is I try to read our text from as many different translations as I can. And I love the way that Eugene Peterson, in his translation called The Message, translated the first part of this verse. He said this, and I quote Peterson on this, everything in the world is about to be wrapped up. Now, we've been thinking about toughen up, Buttercup. And so this morning, we're going to think about toughen up for the wrap-up, okay? And I got that because Peterson said everything in the world is about to be wrapped up. And I think he's probably right. Now, continuing in verse 8, he says, above all, keep fervent in your love for one another because love covers a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without complaint. As each one has received a special gift, employ it in serving one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Whoever speaks, it is to do so as one who is speaking the utterances of God. Whoever serves is to do so as one who is serving by the strength which God supplies, so that in all things God may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom belongs the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Toughen up for the wrap up. Let me make a sentence. I think you would agree with me about this. Where you live and when you live ought to have a great deal to do with how you live. Let me say it again. Where you live and when you live ought to have a great deal to do with how you live. Now, a while back, Mount St. Helens was having a few tremors. And, you know, it's getting to be quite common in our world for volcanoes to show signs of life. Seismologists didn't worry about it. They just said these are hiccups, nothing to worry about. But of course, you realize Friday night there was a major eruption in the South Seas, and there is still a tsunami warning for our West Coast today. Now, not a major wave. They expect it to be around 3 feet or so. But activities of volcanoes are something we're kind of used to. We hear about it all the time now. Every time I hear of something happening underneath Mount St. Helens, I think back to May of 1980 when there was a major eruption and so much damage was done. Now, anyone who lived near the mountain was in a dangerous, precarious position. I remember about 17 years after that, Pierce Brosnan and Linda Hamilton made a movie called Dante's Peak. And it's a good, clean movie, and it shows the artist's rendition of what they think a volcano would be like. And I'll tell you, it's terrifying. It is scary. And as I went back and watched this week some of the things that happened with Mount St. Helens, I think the movie was largely based on that because some of the lines were the same and their judgment was the same. They knew something was about to happen. Now, if you lived near Mount St. Helens in May of 1980, you were in a very dangerous position. It ought to have made a difference in how you live during that time. Last fall, our little six-year-old grandson, he was six at the time, he's now seven, but Elliot had seen something about volcanoes, and he didn't believe that they were real. It was just something he thought that was imaginary. And so Callie was talking to Finley about it, something about a volcano, and Elliot said, wait, are you telling me that volcanoes are real? Callie said, yes. He said, and magma is real? She said, yes. He said, whoa, that changes everything. Now, I'll tell you what, it does. If you understand that those things are real and how dangerous they can be, it will help determine how you live your life. It just will. There are a lot of times that dangers are near. Melvin Davis was telling me that he and Lori were on vacation in Florida. You never think about things happening in Destin, Florida. White sand, gentle waves, beautiful beach. And the day they were there, a sinkhole opened up and a little 9-year-old boy was sucked in. Now, they managed to save that little fella, but it almost killed not only him, but the rescue worker who was trying to get him out. Whoever thought about being worried about a sinkhole on a beach in Florida? We've been there many times. We don't worry about that. Sometimes there's danger around you, and you don't even know it. And Peter's going to address some of those things, and I want us to pay close attention to it, because Peter makes a very interesting statement in verse 7 when he says, the end of all things is near. One commentator that I was reading said that you could actually translate that, the end of all things is very near. The wrap-up is not far off. Now, he's referring, of course, to the end times, the return of the Lord Jesus. And I know that Scott preached on this just a couple of weeks ago, but we're going to see it from Peter's perspective this morning, as well as what Scott shared with you about the second advent when he comes again. Now, some will say Peter was flat wrong. I mean, this was 2,000 years ago. Was Peter wrong? No. Peter wasn't wrong to say the end of all things is near. As a matter of fact, that's the way the New Testament addresses it, and I'll explain why in just a moment. But Peter was in a unique position at a unique time, and he understood history. He understood what was going on. Peter understood, as he watched the Lord Jesus and saw his life unfold, that the end of Jewish law was coming. Those who had been followers of the Lord God according to the law were about to have a brand new revelation. From that point on, they would not be held so accountable to the law as they were to God's grace. And Peter understood that. And Peter understood that this time when grace would be supreme started on the day that Jesus was resurrected, and it will end on the day that Jesus comes back to earth. In the meanwhile, we're saved by this amazing grace of God. And while we still do so many of the things that the law talks about, we're not under the law, we're under grace. Peter understood that, and he actually took the same position that the other New Testament writers did as well. Actually, Peter in Acts chapter 2, verse 17 was talking about this event, and he said, and it shall be in the last days, God says, that I will pour out my Spirit on mankind. Now, Peter saw on the day of Pentecost the Spirit of God being poured out, and he said, this is what he was referring to in the end days, the last days. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 11, the Apostle Paul said it this way. Now, these things happened to them as an example, and they're written for our instruction. Now, listen, upon whom the ends of the ages has come. Or in Hebrews 1, 2, the writer of Hebrews. I have no trouble believing it's the Apostle Paul. Others would say, no, it was somebody else. Whoever wrote it said this. In these last days, God has spoken to us in his Son. Whoever wrote Hebrews said, we're in the last days. You kind of see the drift of the New Testament? Well, let me give you a couple more. Philippians 4, 5, the Apostle Paul again said, let your gentle spirit be known to all men, the Lord is near. Or James 5, 8, James said it this way, you too, be patient, strengthen your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is near. And then in verse 9, he went on to say, the judge is standing right at the door. And then the Apostle John in 1 John 2:18 said, children, it is the last hour, and just as you've heard that Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have appeared. From this we know that it is the last hour. Now, this is the same position that you and I should take. You see, what they're saying is simply this. They knew that the return of the Lord was imminent, though it was not necessarily immediate. Now, what I mean by that is simply this. The coming of the Lord was imminent. It could happen at any moment. But that did not necessarily mean that it was immediate, that it was going to happen today. It could happen today, but it may not. That's immediate. When we say imminent, it means it could happen at any time, and it could. Now, this is why, and really, this is how we should live our lives in light of that. Now, Some people, in fact, there's an interesting passage that speaks to this subject in 2 Peter chapter 3. You might just turn there. I don't think I asked Jackie to put that on the screen for you. But in 2 Peter chapter 3, notice what some were saying. In verse 3, Peter said this, "Know this, first of all, that in the last days, mockers will come with their mocking, following after their own lusts and saying, 'Where's the promise of his coming? For ever since the fathers fell asleep, all continues just as it was from the beginning of creation.'" Now, think with me about that. What they're saying is, well, you know, he said he was going to come. He hasn't come. He's not coming. Think of the logic of that. That's like saying, "I didn't break my leg. Therefore, I'll never break my leg." I mean, that doesn't make sense, does it? Well, that's what they were saying. Well, he hasn't come yet, so he's not coming. Well, just because he hasn't come yet doesn't mean he's not coming, ladies and gentlemen. He is coming. Now, you, I think, would agree with me that whenever he comes, we are closer now than anyone who has lived before us. It's kind of like the couple that were laying in bed one night and the grandfather clock went off. And it chimed 20 times. And he grabbed his wife and he said, "Honey, wake up. It's later than it's ever been." And it is. It is later today than it's ever been. Now, will he come today? I don't know. But you don't know that he won't. We just don't. We don't know. And that's why where you live on the edge of eternity and when you live at the closing of an end, at the end of the age, ought to help determine how you live. I hope you see what Peter is talking about. Knowing that we're in the last days, we ought to live a certain way. And that's why in verse 7, Peter said, "Therefore." Look at it again in verse 7. Let me get back to the same passage. He said, "The end of all things is near. Therefore, be of sound judgment and be sober, sober spirit for the purpose of prayer." As a result of the end times being upon us, there are some things that we ought to do. Now, our message will really have two main points this morning that I want you to think about. First of all, there are some implications for our daily lives. I mean, if Jesus' coming is near, there are some implications for our daily lives. And we're going to look at that. And the second main point that we're going to be thinking of is there are some motivations for our daily lives. He's going to conclude this passage and give us some motivation for living the way we live. Now, let's just jump into it. In verse 7, he talks about some implications for our daily lives. And first of all, he talks about those implications regarding our Heavenly Father. As a result of knowing our Heavenly Father, there are two things we ought to keep in mind. Number one, you'll notice he says sound judgment in verse 7. The end of all things is near, therefore be of sound judgment. Now, what he's saying is in these crazy days in which we live, we need to think through and make good decisions. Use sound judgment. Don't do stupid things. There's an old adage that I think applies to this. It says, "He who would not slip down ought not walk in slippery places." Now, that's just good sense. Just makes sense. It really does. And you see, you need to use sound judgment. Sometimes people say, "Well, everybody else is doing it." Really? And that justifies you doing it? I personally think right now it's not a good time to go deep, deep, deep in debt. You know, with inflation rising, they say it was 7% last month. You know, it's probably not a good time to sink yourselves in debt because you don't know where it's going to end. And you have to make sure that you can handle your obligations and your commitments. Now, there may be exceptions to that rule. God may tell you to do something and go into debt today, and if he does, that's fine. But the rule of thumb is you need to be careful. Use sound judgment. Look at all the things going on around you and make a good call. Don't do dumb things. And then he says not only sound judgment, but he also says be sober. Now, he's not talking about alcohol there. He talked about that in a few verses prior to this. In fact, he nailed that coffin shut very hard. He went over it a couple of ways and a couple of different times. So he's not talking about drinking alcohol here. He's talking about an attitude that we have. And he did not say, not only is it not alcohol, it's also not somber. He didn't say go around looking like you've been weaned on dill pickles. you know, you don't have to live a somber life, but you live a sober life. And that means simply, folks, that you are serious-minded about the things of God, that you're not flippant. You're not treating the things of God casually. You understand that this is an opportunity we have to walk with the Lord. And so you walk soberly. In other words, in spite of everything that's going on around us, you can be cool. You don't have to panic. God is still in control, and you just need to keep that in mind. Now, I'm like everybody else. I watch the news, and I tend to think, oh, no. Where's this inflation thing going to end? What's going to happen? We don't know. But we know who's in control. And we have to learn to trust him. And so you approach it soberly, not stupidly, but soberly. You know, you don't want to be an ostrich with your head in the sand. And by the way, did you know we use that figure of speech? As best I can tell, there's never been an incident of an ostrich putting his head in the sand. Did you know that? Isn't that strange? I don't know how that thing got started, but I use it, obviously, too. But our day is a crazy day. And, of course, he talks about this using sound judgment and being sober in light of our prayer life, because in verse 7, he goes on to say, sober spirit for the purpose of prayer. He's talking about our prayer life here, particularly because we're dealing with some implications regarding our Heavenly Father. We need to be in communication with the Lord. Isn't it amazing what can happen in 5 minutes? Did you know in 5 minutes you could send a burst of electricity, if you had lines around the earth, you could send it around the earth 6,000, not six, but 6,000 times. In 5 minutes, an electrical current could circle the earth, 25,000 miles in circumference. It could circle the earth 6,000 times in 5 minutes. Amazing. In 5 minutes, at the speed of light, you can travel 55.9 million miles in 5 minutes. But I'll tell you something even greater than that. In 5 minutes, you can launch a prayer all the way to heaven and have an impact on somebody halfway around the globe. You may never send a burst of energy, electricity around the earth, and you certainly may never travel at the speed of light, but I'll tell you something, you do have the privilege of being involved in prayer, and in 5 minutes, you can change someone's life. It's an amazing thing. And that's why he's saying, listen, think this thing through. Use sound judgment. Be sober-minded, especially when we're talking about prayer. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a tremendous opportunity to approach the King of Kings. It's an amazing thing. God has opened up. In fact, even told us to come boldly before the throne of grace, that we might find mercy and help in our times of need. Isn't that amazing that God would do that? And yet, you know, so many Christians I know never take 5 minutes for prayer. And there may be some here today who'll let a whole day go by and never utter a prayer to our Heavenly Father. Now, there are some implications regarding our Heavenly Father. You need to be praying. That's how you're going to have sound judgment, and it'll certainly help you be sober-minded. But not only are there some implications for our Heavenly Father, there's also some implications concerning our heavenly family. Now, notice, if you will, in verses 8 and 9, he picks up, and he talks about, in verse 8, above all. Now, this is priority. This is important. When he says above all, he's saying tune in. Don't take this lightly. This is important, these things that I'm about to share. He says, keep fervent in your love for one another, because love covers a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without complaint. Now, let's think about that for just a moment. Above all, it is a priority. You need to understand that your relationship with brothers and sisters in Christ is a huge priority for each one of us. Do you know why we have community groups? Do you know why we encourage people to be in Sunday school classes? So that you can get to know your brothers and sisters in Christ. You can't do it in a worship service. You're not going to get to know people by sitting in church during a regular worship service. You really can't do that. But you can in a community group. And you can in a Sunday school class. And the strange thing is, if we're not committed to something like that, we can let days, weeks, even months go by and not have interaction with our brothers and sisters in Christ. Let me tell you something, folks. We need each other. We need the encouragement. We need the comfort. We need the support. We need the prayers. We need each other. We do. And that's why he says, above all, you need to understand Your relationship with your heavenly family is important. And you'll notice the way he says it, first of all, is in verse 8, keep fervent in your love for one another. Now, this speaks about the fact that love, real love, costs something. This word fervent literally means to stretch out. The word picture is that of an athlete at the end of a race. And you've all seen runners, and they're trying to break that tape at the end, and they're leaning and they're stretching and they're putting everything they have into it. They're stretching as tall as they can and as much at an angle as they can without falling down, because the first one to break that tape is the winner. And what he's saying is that's the way we ought to be involved in loving one another. It does take effort, doesn't it? Now, I know that we're not always lovable. I know that I'm not always lovable, but you see, you have to love me, and I have to love you. And it's going to cost us something. It's going to take some effort. We're going to have to stretch ourselves a bit to do that. You know, I love my wife dearly. We're coming up on 50 years of marriage. Doggone it, sometimes I have to work at loving her. And you think that's bad. Sometimes she has to work really hard at loving me. And I understand that. We really do. Maybe I'm the only one here who's been grumpy for no reason. But I doubt it. We just, and I think especially with people we love the most, sometimes we act almost the worst. It's an amazing thing. When you go by the church library, you'll see a picture of Brother Bill Hill on the wall. And Bill said something one time when he was preaching for us that I thought was good. He's not the only one I've heard say it. I've heard several other pastors say it as well. But Bill was preaching and he said this: to be in heaven above with those that I love, ah, that will be glory. But to be here below with those that I know, that's a different story. And it's true, isn't it? I mean, sometimes we're just hard to love. But ladies and gentlemen, we have to be committed to it. Don't let something that someone said hurt your feelings and you mark them off the list. Stretch yourself a bit. Be fervent in your love for them. You see, love will cost you something. But not only that, love will also cover something. It costs something, but it also covers. Love covers. Notice the way he says it in verse 8, because love covers a multitude of sins. Now, this does not mean that in the body of Christ we condone sin. That's not what it means at all. We reject sin, but we do want to love the sinner. You know, you can pick any sin you want to. I was talking to someone this week, and it's amazing how things that 40 years ago shocked people don't shock people anymore. You know, I remember growing up, it was almost scandalous if a couple lived together. Now they're almost expected to before they marry. It's an amazing day and age. But you know something? God's seventh commandment is still true. We can't approve of that, but we don't need to turn them away. You know, we need to love them, and love them sometimes means being truthful with people and speaking the truth in love. We don't condone sin. Homosexuality is another issue, and that's going to be bigger and bigger and bigger in our day and age. Things, again, that 40 years ago, you realize just 40 years ago, that was still by the American Medical Association considered a psychological malady. And now, all of a sudden, we're supposed to embrace it wholeheartedly. You know, the Bible still says it's sin. But that doesn't mean that we reject the person. Our goal is to love them. And again, love them enough to be honest and truthful about it. And this is in contrast to the way the devil does. You know, the Bible says that love covers a multitude of sins. And God does that. One of my favorite verses is Proverbs 28:13. Whosoever confesses his sin, whosoever covers his sin shall not prosper, but whosoever confesses and forsakes them shall find mercy. God says, you know, when you're dealing with your sin, if you'll be honest about it and open up and say, here it is, God says, I'll bury it, I'll cover it. But on the other hand, if you try to cover it, God says, I'll expose it, I'll bring it to light. God loves to cover our sins. He loves to love just covers a multitude of sins. And that's just the opposite of the devil. The devil always wants to expose and to shame and to ridicule you. You see, love covers a multitude of sins, and we need to be willing to overlook, especially those faults in our brother's lives. Don't mark a brother off. Don't judge the man by a moment. In one moment, any of us can do or say anything. Don't mark him off the list, because that love covers those kinds of things. But not only does love cover, love also cares. Notice in verse 9, be hospitable to one another without complaint. I think you guys do a good job of being hospitable to one another. One of the things that I love to see is when there has been a death in our church family and families are grieving, there are a group of ladies, and men could do it, but, you know, our ladies are just better at it. They certainly cook better. And they provide a meal for all the whole family that's grieving to get together and have some time, not have to worry about making a meal or buying a meal, just be able to sit down and enjoy the time together. I have heard, I think I can say dozens plural of people to say, Pastor, that meant so much that our church would just take us in and just love us like that. I'll tell you something I'm glad that's going on right now, and that's the hospitality that we're showing on game day with Upward Basketball. You know, the last two Saturdays, a group of our men have been there offering free coffee, offering a conversation. You know, I sat down yesterday and talked to a couple of people. One of them didn't want me talking to him, quite frankly. You talk about being weaned on a dill pickle. This guy was sour. And I tried to be hospitable, and I tried to be friendly, and he would have none of it. And so you just move on. You know, all you can do is offer. But then I met another man and sat down with him, and we had a great time in the Lord. This guy was already a brother in Christ, but what a neat thing it is for us to have a cup of coffee for him and to say, hey, just kick back and just enjoy the time in between the games. And, you know, I'm confident that that hospitality that we're showing, God will honor. I really do. I think it's so neat that our men's ministry had this vision and promoted it and now are pulling it off. And by the way, it doesn't have to be men. You ladies can join in too. You see, the fact of the matter is we'll have hundreds of people cycle through this place on a Saturday. Now, the last two Saturdays, I've been here in the morning, and then I've been here in the afternoon too. And some of the people are the same, but not all of them. There are a lot of people that we have the chance because they've come to us. They've darkened our doors. And for us to be hospitable to them, to welcome them, make them feel at ease, make them feel at home. Give them a cup of coffee. It's a neat, neat ministry. And I think Central's doing some things right, and I think you do really well on that. But you see, the fact of the matter is, not only does love cost and not only does love cover, but love also cares. It is a hospitable love that we're talking about. Now, notice, if you would, not only the implications for our daily lives, but notice, if you will, the motivation for our daily lives. Now, notice in verse 10 what he says. The last two verses deal with this. As each one has received a special gift, employ it in serving one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Now, we're to understand that God has given us some motivational gifts. As a matter of fact, when I taught gifts to our church several years back, we call these They're depending on which approach you take, I've read several books on gifts of the Spirit. Flynn wrote one called The 17 Gifts of the Spirit, and it just depends on how many you want to, you know, what you want to consider a gift, and is the Ephesians 4 list a part of that or not? You know, a lot of ways to break it down, but the one approach that I like is the one that I learned in 1977, where there are seven primary motivational gifts. Now, you'll notice he calls them spiritual, a special gift in verse 10. The word special is in italics. Now, it's there for a reason because these are special gifts, but when it's in italics, it means it's not really there in the Greek. The Greek word is the word charismata, and it means grace, gifts. These are gifts that God gives you out of grace. They're grace gifts. The Greek word charis, C-H-A-R-I-S, is the word for grace. And by the way, when you're thinking about that, realize that hidden inside of charis, C-H-A-R-I-S, is the little word care, C-H-A-R. That's the word for joy. You see, these grace gifts will give you joy when you use them the way God wants you to use them. And these are special gifts. They're not natural talents. They're not natural abilities. But there are seven primary motivational gifts that God gives us to help us live our lives. And I hope that in your past, somewhere you've studied this out and you know how you're gifted. So you're not a square peg in a round hole. And you know how God wants to use you with these special gifts that God has given you, these grace gifts. Now, let me say this. These gifts are not for your enjoyment, though you will enjoy them. You'll enjoy using them. There is joy in that. But they're not given primarily for your enjoyment. They're given for your employment. God wants you to employ them in the body of Christ. Make a note of 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7. You don't have to look it up now, but let me just tell you basically what it says. He says that these gifts are to be used, now listen, for the common good. God gave you these gifts for your use in the body of Christ. It's a part of this loving our brothers and sisters in Christ. And he actually breaks it down to us. He says there's two categories. There's the speaking category, and there's the serving category. And you know something? He's exactly right. Exhortation, prophecy, teaching, these are speaking gifts. But when you look at the other four gifts, administration, service, giving, mercy, these are service gifts. Now, what he's saying is when you use your speaking gift, use it in the anointing and in the power of God. Realize it's a grace gift, and God gave it to you to be a blessing to the body. Notice what he says in verse 10, as each one has received a special gift, employ it in serving one another as a good steward of the manifold grace of God. You use it in the body. God gave it to you to be a blessing to the body of Christ. And let me show you a neat little thing about verse 10. You'll notice at the end of the verse, he talks about the manifold grace of God. You may not catch this in some translations, and I'm sad to say my favorite translation is the New American Standard, but it doesn't point out this out either. And the King James does, actually. I want you to go back, if you would, to chapter 1, and notice, if you would, in chapter 1, what is it? Let me find my gift, my verse. Where is it? 1:6, chapter 1, verse 6. He says, in this you greatly rejoice, even though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials. Underscore that word various. And out beside it, write 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10. Because the word various there is the very same word that's in chapter 4, verse 10. The King James translates it this way, you're distressed by manifold trials. Now, the word literally means many colors. There's a lot of different shades, if you will, of the trials that we go through. But here's the thing, ladies and gentlemen. For every shade of trial that some of us go through, there is a shade of grace to cover it. It's the manifold grace of God to cover the manifold trials that we go through. It is not by accident that same word, it's the exact same word in the Greek language that is used here. And that is not by accident. Now, God wants you to use your gift in the body to be a blessing to your brothers and sisters in Christ. And if you realize that by your use of that gift in the body, you're not only going to be used by the creator of the universe, but you're going to have joy in doing it. Ladies and gentlemen, that's a big motivation. I mean, what more could you want? Think of that. The two-pronged approach of that. You are being used by God. The God who created this universe, you're being used by him? What an honor. But in the process of doing that, you receive joy from these grace gifts? What a blessing. You see, it's not only an honor, it's a blessing. What a motivation it is to serve the Lord. That's what he's talking about. Now, we're talking about sometimes people are in danger and don't even know it. I mentioned May of 1980. There's a story, an interesting story to me at least, of a man who was there that day. His name was Harry Truman. Now, this is not President Harry Truman, but it's this Harry Truman, Harry R. Truman. Now, Harry was the caretaker of a recreation lodge on Spirit Lake. Spirit Lake was 5 miles on the north side of Mount St. Helens. And they went to Harry. They went to everyone who lived anywhere near Mount St. Helens, and they said, you know something? All the scientific evidence is indicating this mountain is going to blow. Harry, you need to leave. You need to go. Now, he had 16 cats. You need to get your cats, Harry, and you need to get away from this mountain. We think it's going to blow. You know what he said? And I quote, nobody knows more about this mountain than Harry, and it don't dare blow up on him. Harry was wrong. At 8:31 in the morning, Sunday morning, of May 18th, 1980, it did blow. And it was incredible. The concussion waves traveled faster than the speed of sound, and they flattened everything, every tree, everything for 150 square miles. The explosion was 500 times greater than the bomb that was dropped on Hiroshima. Unbelievable. And in fact, we have some other pictures. Let me just show you a few. This is Harry again. That's Mount St. Helens in the background, of course, before it blew. This was as the dome inside was building. They knew something was about to happen because it was bulging up. And then on May 18th, it really began to put on quite a show. But that's the before and after. That's the north side of the mountain. And Harry Truman was buried, along with his 16 cats, under 50 feet of mud and ash, and he died almost immediately. He didn't realize where he was living and when he was living. You live near a volcano, especially an active volcano that's about to blow, you need to live differently. You need to listen to people and move when they say move. It cost Harry his life. But you know what? We're living in a very precarious day too. We don't know what's going to happen. But we certainly ought to live our lives for the Lord and be serious-minded, sober-minded. That's what Peter is saying. We need to toughen up for the wrap-up because it's coming. Let's bow our heads for a moment, if we may. Heads bowed and eyes closed. Just for a moment. It may be that some of you this morning need to make some decision. Maybe God's dealing with you about salvation. Maybe about being serious. You've not been serious about the things of God. Maybe God is moving in your heart today. And if you'd like to talk to someone, we want to talk to you. After the service is over, Scott and Billy will be down front. They would love to talk to you. Just in this moment of invitation, I want you to just be serious about the Lord. Are you squandering the opportunity you have today to walk with God? To spend time in prayer? To be serious-minded, sober-minded, sound judgment? How dangerous that can be. What a waste of an opportunity. If you've never been saved, please understand, you're in danger. We don't know when this thing's going to wrap up. It may not be today, but it could be. Now is not the time to squander your opportunity. Don't be a Harry Truman. Father, while our heads are bowed and eyes closed, I pray that you do what only you can do. Bring conviction of sin and righteousness and judgment to come. I pray, Father, that we would be open to whatever you would lead us to do, whatever decision you'd like us to make. Have your way in every heart, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Now again, we're going to officially close our time together, but Scott and Billy will be down front. If you'd like to talk, we'd love for you to do that. God bless you. You're dismissed.